middle-sized chair, and the great big bear had a great big chair. And they each had a bed to sleep in. The little wee bear had a little wee bed. The middle-sized bear had a middle-sized bed. And the great big bear had a great big bed. One morning, the three bears made porridge for breakfast and poured it into their bowls. But it was too hot to eat, so they decided to go for a walk in the woods until it cooled. While the three bears were walking, a little girl named Goldilocks came to their house. First she looked in at the window, and then she peeked through the keyhole. Of course there was nobody inside. Goldilocks turned the handle of the door. The door was not locked, porridge of the great big bear, but it was too hot. Then she tasted the porridge of the middle-sized bear, but it was too cold. Then she tasted the porridge of the little wee bear. It was neither too hot nor too cold, but just right. Goldilocks liked it so much that she ate it all up. Then Goldilocks went into the parlor to see what else she could find. There were the three chairs. First, she sat in the chair of the great big bear, but it was too hard. Then she sat down in the chair of the middle-sized bear, but it was too soft. Then she sat down in the chair of the little wee bear. It was neither too hard nor too soft, but just right. Goldilocks liked it so much that she rocked and rocked until the bottom of the chair fell out. Down she went, plump, onto the floor. Goldilocks went into the bedroom where the three bears slept. First she lay down upon the bed of the great big bear, but it was too high at the head for her. Then she lay down upon the bed of the middle-sized bear, but it was too high at the foot for her. Then she lay down upon the bed of the little wee bear. It was neither too high at the head nor too high at the foot, but just right. Goldilocks liked it so much that she covered herself up and fell fast asleep. By this time, the three bears thought their porridge would be cool enough, so they came home for breakfast. Goldilocks had left the spoon of the great big bear in his porridge bowl. He noticed it first. "Somebody has been tasting my porridge," said the great big bear in his great big voice. Goldilocks had left the spoon of the middle-sized bear in her porridge bowl too. "Somebody's been tasting my porridge," said the middle-sized bear in her middle-sized voice. Then the little wee bear looked at his bowl. "Somebody has been tasting my porridge and has eaten it all up," cried the little wee bear in his little wee voice. The three bears went into the parlor. Goldilocks had left the cushion crooked in the chair of the great big bear. He noticed it first thing. "Somebody has been sitting in my chair," said the great big bear in his great big voice. Goldilocks had squashed down the cushion in the chair of the middle-sized bear. "Somebody has been sitting in my chair," said the middle-sized bear in her middle-sized voice. Then the wee little bear looked at his chair. "Somebody has been sitting in my chair and has sat right through it," cried the little wee bear in his little wee voice. The three bears went into the bedroom. Goldilocks had pulled the pillow of the great big bear out of place. He he noticed it first thing. "Somebody has been lying in my bed," said the great big bear in his great big voice. Goldilocks had pulled the blanket of the middle-sized bear out of place. "Somebody has been lying in my bed," said the middle-sized bear in her middle-sized voice. Then the little wee bear looked at his bed. "Somebody has been lying in my bed, and here she is," cried the little wee bear in his little wee voice. This woke Goldilocks up at once. There were the three bears all staring at her. Goldilocks was so frightened that she tumbled out of bed and ran to the open window. Out she jumped, and she ran away as fast as she could, never looking behind her. No one knows what happened to Goldilocks after that. As for the three bears, they never saw her again. If you could go to your piece, I'm going to give you pieces of the story, the main parts of the story. Your job is to color them, cut them out, and paste them in order, and then write a sentence under what is happening in the picture. You're going to need both sides. There's going to be four on the front, four on the back. And once you do that, you will have a summary of the story, a quick retelling of the story. So I'm going to get out to you what you will need. I'll start with the first part of the story.
Guess this is the library. Yep.
So the other night, I was out here, and this big animal turned its head and was looking right at me. It took me a second to realize it was an owl. I live in a big city, so I forget that there's owls around me, but owls live just about everywhere. Someone named Destiny has a question for us about owls. Let's give her a call now. Hi, Destiny. That's a great question.
Why do owls say hoo? You know, hoo, 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 like that. Well, I'm going to play you the sounds of four different birds. After listening to each sound, raise your hand if you think it's an owl. Okay, here we go. Sound number one. Okay. Sound number two. Okay. Sound number three. Sound number four.
Yeah.
Okay, are you ready to find out which ones were owls? I'll play each sound again, and as I do, I'll reveal a photo of the bird that made the sound. Here we go. Number three was probably the one you guessed that was an owl. It's the call made by a great horned owl. Sometimes I hear these in the park near my house. They make the classic sound you might have heard in movies, like this. But not all owls sound the same, do they? There are many different kinds or species of owls. Each species of owl makes a different call. This one is a boreal owl. And this one, a barn owl. Sounds terrible. And then this one is a snowy owl. Now, were you surprised? In fact, the great horned owl is one of only a few species of owls that make a hoot-hoot sound. But why do owls make sounds at all? Scientists have studied this. They found out that owls tell other owls where they are by using their calls. Each owl has a territory or an area where it lives and hunts for food. It doesn't want other owls coming into its territory. So by calling, it's usually telling other owls, stay out. Okay. I got one more bird sound for you. See if you can guess what it is.
I hear this sometimes at my house.
Me too. Me too. You have a guess? All right. Now I'll reveal to you what it was. It's not an owl. It's a dove. This bird is called a mourning dove. Mourning doves make a whoo sound, kind of like a great horned owl. They go, woo, woo, woo. So owls aren't even the only birds that say, woo. If you only hear them, but you don't see them, how could you tell them apart? Well, it's pretty easy, actually. Doves are like most birds. They're only out during the daytime. Owls are, of course, nocturnal. You're only going to hear them in the late evening or at night. You can go out in the evening and look for owls. You can even try calling them. They might respond back to you. I'm totally serious. I've made the sound of a barn owl and had one call back to me once. You might even have more than one kind of owl where you live. Where I live, I can hear both barn owls and great horned owls. So, in summary, owls make sounds to tell other owls where they are. Different kinds of owls make different sounds. Not many species actually make that hoo-hoo sound, but you can learn to identify owls, and really any bird, by the sound that they make. That's all for this week's question. Thanks, Destiny, for asking me. Now, for the next episode, I reached into my question jar and found three questions submitted to me that I'm thinking about answering. When this video is done playing, you'll get to vote on one. You can choose from, how many layers are in the earth? Why do people love pumpkins so much? Or how was the alphabet created? So submit your vote when the video is over. I want to hear from all of you watching. There are mysteries all around us. Stay curious and see you next week.
All right, so we have some guests today that you guys have brought with you. So I expanded the STEM Lab so some of your stations will be in the library. If you are table C, can you raise your hand? Table C, stand up. You guys are going to be doing the Marvel station. In the library, you see those green chairs on the floor? You can sit there. And table E, where are you, table E? You girls?
No, I need to tell you something.
Hold on, you girls will be on the floor. Table F, where are you? Two people?
Table F.
All right, so we'll actually put you guys together. So table. E and F, stand up. I was going to put F back there, but I'll remind you. You guys can go to the basketball station. You see it on the table?
Yeah.
So you four girls can join those two girls back there. Perfect. And then the rest of you can use Brian, you for a table. Your grandparents can go here. And you guys may
well,
begin. Once you have a structure, I'll bring over the marker. So we, it's six girls, right? I got three on each side.
No, you can do it.
She made it.
Like I did that thing.
Thank you.
This is called Connect, I guess, huh?
Oh,
Stand up, look at me. Whoop, come back, come back, come back. Eric, you're going to lead it. Just follow behind that person. Perfect. My orange friend, stand up. Look at me. Walk around. Make sure you're in one color so I can call that color. Bill, you're kind of in two. Red, stand up for me. Look this way. Walk around. Stay in line. Bill, stand up. And Charles, you're my moose. Moose is at the end. The last train.
Ow!
Make sure you guys are doing hauls.
These two people doesn't have color. That looks like a VIP.
Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you for allowing us to come here.
Oh, you're welcome. Anytime.
Do 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 do
Yeah, sir.
Thank you.
Why do you have it here?
Thank you.